Dr. Dan, we are so glad that you are here. Our folks that were on the mission trip, the World Changers mission trip, are back in town. We're grateful for what they were able to do. We're also grateful for what the Lord has allowed to occur in our nation and the freedoms that we have based on the sacrifices that people have made. So we give thanks to our God for what He's done, and we look forward to celebrating with others tomorrow. For those of you that are joining online, we welcome you. If you've never connected with us, we'd love to know a little bit about you, get to know you. You can do that either by looking at the rack in front of you and find a connection card, or you can do it electronically. Either way, we'd love to have you connect with us so we can connect with you. Stand with me as we begin our time of worship.
Open the prison doors. Well, amen. Good morning. That's not me, by the way. Because it's in tune. But anyway, that's a whole nother story. I'm Don. It's good to see you all. I've missed several weeks. That's right. Hey, how are you doing? I'm grateful to be back with you all. I'm grateful to be here during these exciting days. You all have exciting days ahead, and I'm grateful to be a part of that. And grateful that we can celebrate the Lord's Supper together. You know, the Lord's Supper is, an opportunity for us to remember. For the past few weeks, I've been away from you. The first week was work. The last 2 weeks was my wife and I celebrating our 30th wedding anniversary. We went up the coast of California, up Route 1, ended in San Francisco. That's about as much as we could stand, and I'm glad that we're home. Just kidding, a little California joke there. But part of what we did was to see some things we'd never seen before, but also to be reminded of God's faithfulness to us over 30 years. And really, that's what the Lord's Supper is a reminder of God's faithfulness to us. As I've told you before, the Lord's Supper is unique in the sense that it is an opportunity for us to look back upon what Jesus did for us. It's a reminder of that because we are forgetful people, aren't we? We forget. Not only are we forgetful, sometimes we become apathetic about it. And I'm glad that each month, on the first Sunday of the month, we remind ourselves of this and we draw ourselves out of our apathy to be reminded of what Jesus has done on our behalf. But I'm also aware that the Lord's Supper provides an opportunity to proclaim the truth because some are ignorant of its truth. So as I've told you before, in one sense, the Lord's Supper looks back upon what Jesus has done. It also looks forward to the moment when we get to celebrate it with Him face to face. It is a door into our future. It is a door of hope. It's a picture of hope. And so we look forward to the future. But also, the Scripture tells us that the Lord's Supper is also an opportunity for us to look inside in our present situation. In fact, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, God wrote through the pen of Paul this: "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." We offer the Lord's Supper to all of you who have embraced Jesus in faith, that you have a born-again relationship with Jesus, and you have been obedient to be publicly and biblically baptized. That's what this Lord's Supper is offered to all of you who are in that situation. But I'm also reminded that the Scripture says we are to examine ourselves, and that's exactly how we will begin. The Lord's Supper allows us, in the context of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it reminds us of what Jesus has done, but it also reminds us that not only does it restore us in relationship with God, it also encourages us to restore our relationships with others. So when we examine ourselves, it's to examine our relationship, present relationship with the Lord, as well as our relationship with others. So in that regard, I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes and talk to the Lord about those very things. come as a needy people. Our relationship with you has been broken, and you've provided a way for that brokenness to be mended. Our relationships with others are broken, and you provide a way for them to be mended through Jesus. Thank you that you are a God who intervenes. And thank you for this Lord's Supper that reminds us of Jesus' body broken for us, his blood spilt for us, that we might be in covenant, in relationship with you. Not only are we grateful for it, we're overwhelmed by it. And we ask you, guide our time by your holy and precious Spirit. Amen. I've asked some friends to help me serve you, and they have joined me here at the front. Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, first of all, took the bread and explained to them that it symbolized his body broken for us. All of you who believe, eat of it. Thank you, God, for Jesus' body broken for us. Jesus also shared with them a cup, and he explained to them that the cup symbolized his blood spilt for us, that we might have a covenant, a relationship with God. All of you who believe, drink of it. Thank you, O loving Father, for Jesus' body broken for us and his blood spilt for us, that we might have a relationship with you, an open door. And we look forward to the day when we celebrate that face to face, not just with our loved ones, but with our Savior. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Thank you, gentlemen. Thanks, Dr. Dan. I'm taking you on the road with me, buddy. Turn, if you would, in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6. We're going to focus on verse 11. And I rejoice to tell you that during the first service, you all weren't there, so I'll tell you what happened. Dreama King, as well as Aaron and Haley Albrecht, joined our church as members of our church. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. God is on the move. Independence Day, or the 4th of July, has been a federal holiday since the year 1941. It's interesting that it became official in 1941 because I would probably make the case that the rebirth of our nation took place later in 1941. December 7th, I believe, was the beginning of what I believe to be the rebirth of our nation, but the tradition of Independence Day celebrations goes back into the 18th century and the American Revolution. On July 2nd, 1776, the Continental Congress voted in favor of independence from Great Britain, and 2 days later, delegates from the 13 colonies adopted the Declaration of Independence, a historical document drafted by Thomas Jefferson and the Committee of Five, the majority of which were Virginians, by the way. I'm just not saying I love Virginia, but I'm just saying. From 1776 to the present day, July 4th has been celebrated as the birth of American independence. It is our birthday as a nation. We celebrate it with all kinds of festivities, everything from fireworks, parades, and concerts to family cookouts in the backyard, and if you give me your address, I'll be glad to be there tomorrow. July 4th is a big birthday celebration, and you know there's much to be grateful to God in the formation of our nation. For example, we can rejoice in the religious liberty that we currently enjoy. We can rejoice in the promotion of human flourishing and freedom around the world. We can rejoice in God using America to protect the right for people to pursue life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We can also rejoice in our growth as a nation and learning from our sins and failures, and they are many, but also standing up for the vulnerable and the needy. July 4th is a day when we commemorate all that. You know, it's a remarkable coincidence also that both Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, signatories of the Declaration of Independence, they were the only two to go on and serve as presidents of the United States. They both died on the same day, July 4th, 1826, 50 years after the Declaration of Independence. But I'm here to tell you that on this Independence Day weekend, let us realize that while we can celebrate our nation's history and acknowledge our independence, we must, more importantly, acknowledge our rightful dependence upon the Lord. And that's what Matthew chapter 6, verse 11 proclaims. Will you stand in honor of reading God's word? Matthew chapter 6, verse 11. And God wrote through the pen of Matthew, "Give us this day our daily bread." God, we open your book and we ask, Lord, that you open our minds and hearts, that our spirit would receive the truth. Help us to see the truth, and that by your Holy Spirit, give us courage and boldness to act on what you teach us, we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Please be seated. Matthew 6:11 serves as a transition in the Lord's Prayer. The first three petitions recorded in the Lord's Prayer, verses 9 and 10, teach us to pray focusing on your. It is focusing on God's name, God's kingdom, God's will. It says, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. These petitions focus, again, on God's name, his kingdom, his will. The remaining petitions, verses 11 through 13, teach us to pray focusing on us and our. It says, give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. These petitions address our need for bread, forgiveness, and deliverance. But this transition from you to our does not suggest that these are competing or conflicting priorities in prayer. It does not suggest that we come bowing before God's throne to address his priorities, and then God changes places with us, and then we address our priorities. No, the model prayer is meant to teach us how to approach God in prayer. In all these petitions, God occupies the place of priority. We are praying to the Lord. He is our priority when we pray. And when we pray about God's name, his kingdom, and his will, we are expressing our devotion to God. And when we pray for bread, forgiveness, protection, and deliverance, we're expressing our dependence upon God. And when our needs become the subject of our prayers, God continues to remain the object of our prayers. When we move from praying about God's kingdom to praying about our kitchens, we're still praying about God's priorities. Our bread is God's priority. This model prayer teaches us to make God's priorities our priorities, and in the process, we learn that we are one of God's priorities. A friend of mine said a few months before he died an absolute truth. He said, what God wants is always what is best for you. My pastor used to say, God's will is what we would strongly desire ourselves if we knew any better. And I think he was right. As we're now permitted and called to focus on ourselves in prayer, the Lord sets the agenda. And the first thing he leads us to pray for is daily bread. This petition teaches us to approach God in prayer, trusting that he is ready, willing, and able to meet our needs. I'm very grateful for my friend and acquaintance, H.B. Charles, who told me the story of William Stillman Martin and his wife, Sevilla. Reverend Martin, in the early 1900s, would travel around the country and preach crusades. His wife, Sevilla, would play the piano, and they would often sing songs that they had written. In 1904, they spent several weeks at the Practical Training Institute in Leicestershire, New York. President John Davis invited them to come and prepare a songbook for their school. And while there, Mr. Martin intended to keep an appointment, a speaking engagement that was quite some distance from the school. But on that particular Sunday morning, his wife, Sevilla, became suddenly ill. And he had a dilemma on his hands. If he went to preach, he would not be able to take care of her. He was kind of concerned about that. And as he and his wife had a discussion about this, after 30 years, by the way, I heard someone say that marriage is the art of constant renegotiation. That's what they were having. They were having a renegotiation. And in the process, their young son heard this discussion, and he said, Father, don't you think that if God wants you to preach today, that he'll take care of mother? Duly chastised, Mr. Martin went to that preaching engagement, and indeed, God did restore his wife, Sevilla, to feeling better, but the words of her son ringing in her ears, she began to write down words that God gave her. And when her husband returned, he being quite a good musician himself, he put those words to music, and they sang that song the very next day in chapel, and it became a part of that songbook. But that songbook, though long forgotten, the song itself is very familiar. We sing it today. Here's some of the words. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath His wings of love abide, God will take care of you. Through days of toil, when heart does fail, God will take care of you. When dangers fierce your path assail, God will take care of you. No matter what may be your test, God will take care of you. Lean, weary one, upon God's breast, God will take care of you. Praise God for William Stillman Martin and his dear wife, Savilla. Those words come to us today, and those are words I want to bring to you today. God will take care of you. Spent the past several months trying to help you during this time of transition, and you want to hear some final words from me. This is not the final words from me, but some of the final words I have for you today is God will take care of you. Trust that. But let me ask you, what are the things in your life that are distracting you from trusting God, from God's spiritual priorities? I want you to know that the God of the hallowed name, the coming kingdom, the sovereign will, is also the God of daily bread, verse 11. Matthew 6, 8 and Matthew 6, 32, in the same context of this passage, tell us that God knows what we need even before we ask. In fact, Matthew 6, 33, Jesus says, if you seek His kingdom and His righteousness, all these things will be added to you. God will take care of you, and you can trust Him in that. This is a great petition. Every word of it is important. First of all, he says, give. It speaks of God's sovereignty and His providence, His resources. Give us. Us speaks of community and generosity. This day speaks of total confidence for today and freedom from worrying about tomorrow. Our speaks of industry and integrity. Daily speaks of dependence on the unfailing faithfulness of God. Bread speaks of all of our physical and material needs. Every word of verse 11 are important. And to pray this petition, number one, we acknowledge that we need divine provision. That's the first point we notice. To pray this petition is to acknowledge that you need divine provisions. The plain meaning of the text here is obvious. Daily bread is the food that you need day by day to survive. At the same time, bread covers more than food. Bread symbolizes all of our physical needs. It represents what food produces: strength to walk, work, drive, type, to serve. Bread symbolizes money, time, a job, other material things. Bread stands for a car that gives you transportation or money to get on the bus. Bread stands for heat in winter and air conditioning in the summer. And by the way, in the South, praise God for air conditioning in the summer. Bread gives us stamina to close that business deal. Bread gives us keeps our minds clear to think and plan. Bread stands for physical healing so you can work and get a raise so you can support your family. Bread stands for all the material things that you need. And this verse is very offensive to the modern mind to think that we would ask God to give us bread. All we've got to do is go down the street and to buy some. But this verse reminds us God gives us bread to eat. In fact, He gives us all the physical things that we need. To pray this verse, give us this day our daily bread, forces us to acknowledge that bread does not automatically show up on our tables. Bread comes from a source outside of ourselves. If it is not provided, we will die. In praying this petition, we acknowledge that we need divine provisions. When we pray this prayer, we confess our humanity. It forces us to admit that we are not self-sufficient. Our physical needs are met because God keeps putting bread on our table. Go ahead, work hard, save money, plan wisely, but do not forget that you need God. You need divine provisions to get to heaven. You need divine provisions to get to work in the morning. You need God. The fact that daily bread covers all of our physical material needs says we ought to pray at least as often as we eat. We need God. But let me place a footnote here. This petition also teaches us that we are to pray for bread, not cake. We're to go to God for our needs, not our greeds, not for luxuries. We need to go to God for what we need. We are instructed to pray for our necessities, not luxuries. It's significant that Jesus instructs us to pray for something as basic as bread. In so doing, he is bidding us not to be addicted to the things of this world. We live in a culture that instills within us a spirit of greed and worldliness, covetousness, materialism, and overindulgence. We are ungrateful people. Sometimes we don't even know how to tell ourselves no. We always want more than we have, and it's so easy with that attitude to forget the Lord. But this says, give us this day our daily bread. Jesus insults our desire to be big shots by telling us to pray for bread of all things. This means that the Christian ought not to desire to be rich and wealthy, but instead that we might be blessed and not forget that it's God who has blessed us. We pray for bread to learn how to be content with what we have. We pray for bread to remind us of the abundant life Jesus offers is not in health and wealth. It is in the overabundance of a relationship with God that transcends health and wealth. For you see, if your relationship with God is of the ultimate priority, when your health fails, you still have your relationship with the Lord. And if your wealth falls away, which it will at some point because you will not be taking it with you, your relationship with God cannot be taken away. We pray for bread to acknowledge no matter where we live, we need God. Proverbs 30 puts it this way, "Remove far from me falsehood and lying. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with the food that is needful for me, lest I be full and say, 'Who is the Lord?' Or lest I be poor and profane the name of God." Jesus teaches us to pray the same way. The petition asks God to keep us in a place of dependence upon Him. May that never change. To pray this petition, number one, is to acknowledge that you need divine provision, but it's also, secondly, to affirm that you are trusting in divine provisions. It's to affirm that you are trusting in divine provision. In my role with the SBC Virginia, I get an opportunity to advise and have friendships with lots of pastors, some even who are visiting with us today. And sometimes pastors will call, church leaders will call, and they'll seek advice. But you know, they never call me and ask for $1 million. Because I don't have it. They might know that I have some wisdom, and normally what my wisdom comes from is from situations that I've jacked up myself, and I tell them not to go that way. You see, when we pray for daily bread, we're saying that God can be trusted. We're saying that God is the source of our provision. It's not just expressing our dependence, it's also expressing our confidence that God can meet our need. Give us this day. We're saying that God is able to do just that. It's a statement of trust. And when you pray this provision, when we pray this petition, we are affirming that God is able to supply whatever we need. God is able to help you get and keep a job. God is able to heal your body. God is able to mend broken relationships. God is able to give you wisdom to make the right decision. God is able to protect you in dangerous situations. This petition teaches us to take our needs to God in prayer and trust Him that He can meet those needs. Have you learned to pray that way? We all need to. Sometimes it's good we're in a situation where we have to say, Lord, I don't know what to do. That's a good place to be. Because first of all, it expresses our dependence to God. We're in the rightful place. But secondly, it also is a way for us to express confidence that He is able to meet our needs. And notice how He says it. Give us this day our daily bread. This day says that we are to confidently trust God. This day. We are to confidently trust God. We do not pray that God will give us bread tomorrow, next week, next month, next year. We are concerned about today. And when you pray specifically about today, we're expressing our confidence in God's faithful ability to take care of the rest of our days. Just like we meeting here on the first day of the week, not only is it a celebration of the resurrection of Jesus who rose the first day of the week, it also is symbolic always of the fact that not only is this the Lord's day, but it's symbolic that all of our days belong to Him. It just begins with the first day of the week. In teaching us to pray about this day, Jesus is introducing a point that He'll deal with later in verses 25 through 34 in this chapter when He says, don't worry about tomorrow. He's introducing that idea here. He's saying, trust in God for today and leave tomorrow to the Lord. It doesn't mean we don't plan for tomorrow, but we don't have to worry about tomorrow. My wife and I, as part of our trip to the West Coast, we made a stop at the San Diego Zoo. I'm happy to tell you they didn't try to keep me. While there, I saw an African impala, not the car, the animal, just to be clear. An impala is in the antelope family of animals, and they can jump more than 10 feet in the air, and they can also jump to a distance on one leap of 30 feet. But the amazing thing about the African impala in the San Diego Zoo is they were placed in a lowered cage with a 3-foot wall, and they remain there. You know why? Because the African impala will never jump until they can see where their feet will land. Therefore, a 3-foot wall keeps them enclosed. I wonder how many of us remain captive to our own limitations because we just have to see where our feet will fall. We just have to know what's ahead. But yet this says, give us this day our daily bread, and we're trusting God for tomorrow, trusting that our feet will fall in such a way that God knows where they will land. That's what it's teaching us. If you do not want your life to be limited, you must confidently trust God today, even if you cannot see what tomorrow is going to bring, because you know who holds tomorrow. But not only does it say, give us this day, expressing confidence, secondly, it says, give us this day our daily bread, which means we are to constantly trust God. Daily means that we are regularly and repeatedly to come to God, trusting that He is always able to meet our needs. Have you ever worked for a company or business that one day had to close down? You ever gone to family and friends for help only to find that the help that you needed, they couldn't provide? Well, thank God there's an account that never has insufficient funds. There's a friend who's never broke, and there's a business that is never in danger of closing down. God is able to meet our needs. Psalm 68 puts it this way, blessed be the Lord who daily bears us up. God is our salvation. Philippians 4:19, and my God will supply every need of yours according to His riches in glory in Christ Jesus. The old song goes like this, I don't know about tomorrow, I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I do not worry over the future, because I know what Jesus said, and today I'll walk beside Him, for He knows what lies ahead. Many things about tomorrow, I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know He holds my hand. To pray this petition, to pray for daily bread, first of all, is to acknowledge that you need divine provision. It's to affirm that you're trusting in divine provisions. But thirdly, it's to accept your responsibility to accept your responsibility amid divine provisions. Vance Havner, the great North Carolina preacher of days gone by, used to say, God feeds the birds every day, but he does not put worms in their nests. I think that's a thoroughly biblical concept. In fact, if you just study the miracles of Jesus in the Gospel of John, for instance, you'll see that Christ performed miracles, but he often made the recipients responsible for some role. For example, in John 2, he turns water into wine, his first miracle at the wedding at Cana. And what does he do? He tells them to fill the water pots, and it's he who performs a miracle. In John 5, he heals the man who lay by Bethesda's pool for 38 years. And what does he tell the man? Rise up, take up your mat, and walk. John 9, Jesus heals the man who's been born blind. But how does he do it? He orders the man to wash his face in the pool of Siloam. This affirms for us that even though God provides, that does not mean we do not have responsibilities. What are our responsibilities amidst divine provision? Ephesians 4:28 puts it well. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. This verse summarizes our responsibility. First of all, we must have integrity. It teaches that Christians do not eat stolen bread. We do not lie, cheat, steal, and manipulate to get our needs met. It is our bread in the sense that we do not take bread that rightfully belongs to someone else. You don't have to lie to get your needs met. You don't have to cheat to get your needs met. You don't have to hurt people to get your needs met. You don't need to burn relationship bridges to get your needs met. You don't have to use others to get your needs met. Trust the Lord with integrity. And if you will do right, God will take care of you. Doesn't it say that well at the end of this chapter? Matthew 6:33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. If you do what is right, God will take care of you. Put God first, and he'll provide for your needs. David said it well in Psalm 37. I have been young, and now I am old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging for bread. We must first of all have integrity. But Ephesians 4:28 also tells us we must have industry. We must have industry. It has been well said, without God we cannot do it, and God will not do it without us. 2 Thessalonians 3, for anyone among you, if he would not work, he shall not eat. God will bless you if you do your part. God loves to answer the prayers of those who are willing to do their part, and he answers their prayers. They're a part of the answer. But not only integrity and industry, but also generosity. We must have generosity. God gives us bread so that we might share with others. That's what he says there. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with everyone in need. God blesses you that you might be a blessing. If you think that God blesses you just for your own selves, you miss the point of all of Scripture. God blesses us that we might be a blessing to others. God gives us bread so that we might share with others. When we pray for daily bread, we are reminded that Christians are to be concerned not only with our own needs, but also with the needs of others. Mark it down and understand, many things that we hoard, God views those things as bread that we are stealing from other people. It is disturbing to think how many of us feel that our lives are not valuable because we are not where we want to be, we are not with whom we want to be with, and we do not have what we want to have. Let me tell you, the value of our life is not about how many of our selfish ambitions come to pass. The true value of our time on earth is based on the positive impact that we make on the lives of others. If you really want to be someone significant, be a loving channel through whom divine resources can meet human needs to the glory of God. It's when you're, not only are you blessed, but you're a blessing to others. That makes all the difference in the world. Give us this day our daily bread is not just about us. But to pray this petition, not only is it to acknowledge our need and affirm our trust and accept our responsibility, it also is to, number four, applaud the source of divine provisions. Applaud the source of divine provisions. Now, I need to apologize to you. There's an editing mistake on your sermon notes. There's not two subpoints after this, and that's not Lisa's fault. That's my fault. As my pastor used to say, they asked Dr. Rogers, how many points should a sermon have? And he said, at least one. And I hope this has at least one. We need to applaud the source of divine provisions. In his sermon on the model prayer, the late professor of preaching, Haddon Robinson, recalls playing a game with his children, and this game with his children was interesting. He would put pennies in his hand, and he would clench his fist as strongly as possible, and his children would sit in his lap, and their goal was to pry open those fingers and to get those pennies. And once the fingers were open, it could not be closed again, and when they would grab those pennies, they would run and play. And he thought to himself, oh, if they only knew there was more available from me than just pennies. I wonder if we don't treat God the same way. We settle for penny ante prayers when God has so much more to offer to us. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31 says, so whatever you eat or drink, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. James 1, 17, every good and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. God is worthy of our praise because He is the source of all that we have. When those founding fathers began to meet and to discuss the founding of our nation, there was great argument and conflict among them. I mean, so much so that it appeared that there would be no resolution to that argument. And a wise old sage, his name was Ben Franklin, stood and said this. He said, I've lived a long time, and the longer I live, the more convincing proofs I see of this truth, that God governs in the affairs of men, and if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, is it probable that a nation can rise without his aid? We have been assured in the sacred writings that except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain who build it. By the way, immediately following his comments, the group paused and prayed, eventually settling on the declaration that we celebrate tomorrow. By the way, beginning a tradition that when Congress gathers, they begin the day with prayer, and it all came from Ben Franklin's comments. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. That is true of a nation. That is true of a family. It's also true of a church family. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. And I want to tell you, as one of my final sermons, not my final one, you haven't gotten rid of me quite yet, as one of my final sermons to you as interim pastor, I want you to remember, if you don't remember anything else I've told you, God will take care of you. Next Sunday will be an exciting Sunday, and I want you to know that I know this candidate. In fact, I encouraged him to apply for the position. But once he did, I left it in God's hands. You know why? Because I believed what I just proclaimed to you. I believed that God would take care of you. I love you, and my service to you has been a labor of love. But please remember this. God will take care of you. What else possibly could we ask? Will you pray with me? God, thank you for your divine provision, not just of bread for daily living, but the gift of salvation that you offer through Jesus. That we who are sinners, who in things done that we should not have done, in deeds that we should have done, that we left incomplete. Oh God, thank you for the forgiveness that's offered through our Messiah Jesus, the long promised one who indeed came as prophesied, Jesus Christ, who walked this earth, lived a perfect life, and died and rose again, giving us the potential of also being forgiven and raising again to new life, to be a different person, forgiven, redeemed, accepted, and in covenant relationship with you as our Heavenly Father. Thank you for the gospel of Jesus Christ that reminds us that you do give us daily bread, spiritual bread through Jesus, but daily physical provision that you provide for us. And may we never take it for granted how you provide for us. God, we come and we pray to you, give us this day our daily bread, not just expressing our dependence, but also our confidence in you and praising you for being the source of meeting our every need. Thank you, Lord. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. As we draw to the end of the service, I want to be clear. We're going to sing a final song. And during that time, we offer you an opportunity to respond to what God is saying to you today. For some of you, it might mean that you need to express your faith and trust in Jesus for the first time, to no longer to try to be the master of your own life or the captain of your own soul, but instead to say, Jesus, I need you to be saved, and to be saved, maybe even today. Or maybe for some of you, you have faith in Jesus and you have been born again a second time, but you've never expressed that through biblical baptism, and you need to come and say, I need to be baptized. Or perhaps for some of you, you've been walking with Jesus as a part of this people for some time now, but you want to be a part of what God is doing here, just like those two families in the first service. Perhaps God is calling upon you to be a part of what God is doing here, so you can truly say what we're doing down at our church instead of what they're doing down at that church. Whatever God's calling you to do, step out and come.
Sing, move as the Spirit would have you.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Long as life endures, my chains. Hello, church family. Please have a seat. It's me again. I wanted to come up here and on behalf of the pastor search team, we wanted to share some additional updates and details about the planned events for later this week, which you can see on the displays behind me. So as we've been sharing, on Friday, July 8th, there's going to be a dessert social in the fellowship hall from 6 to 8. And this will be potluck. And we're asking everyone, encouraging everyone who'll be participating to please bring a dessert dish to share with everyone. And Dean Parolis will also be there providing snow cones. And then on Saturday, July 9th, that morning, there will be a breakfast social in the fellowship hall from 9 to 11. And breakfast is going to be provided by the church with Jeff Hoagland and the deacons serving. So whether you prefer dessert or whether you prefer a big breakfast in the morning, we have something for everyone. So please, encouraging everyone to please come on out Friday night or Saturday morning to be able to meet our pastor candidate. Encourage everyone to please be able to do that. And also, anyone able and willing to be able to help with set up before or tear down after on both of these events, please email Willie Klepper if you're able to help. Now, both of these events will be divided into two activities. The first hour of each event will be a time of fellowship with an opportunity to mingle, meet and greet the pastor candidate and his family while also enjoying some food. And then in the second hour, we will adjourn to the sanctuary for Q&A town hall, wherein submitted questions from you for the pastor candidate will be asked. Now, index cards are going to be provided to participants as you arrive at the beginning of the social hour, along with a short bio of our candidate. And we're asking everyone to please write down your questions you have, limit one question per card on these index cards. And then those cards will be collected by the pastor search team during the social hour and then asked of the candidate during the Q&A town hall during the second hour. And we will make every attempt to cover a full range of as many of your questions as possible during that time allotted. Then on Sunday, July 10th, the pastor candidate will be preaching at both morning services with a special called business meeting following after the 11 a.m. service. And the agenda for that special called business meeting has been published as part of the Friday email update and will be published again in the coming week for everyone's knowledge. And also, I ask everyone, let's not forget to honor our seniors. Remember about the senior adult luncheon that is planned to start immediately following the close of our business meeting on that Sunday. I'd just like to ask everyone and remind everyone to please remain in prayer this coming week for our church, for our pastor candidate and his family. Please ask God to bless the events that have been planned, to use those events according to his will to provide clarity to us, to unify us, and to just deepen our understanding of His will and His plan for Villa Heights in the coming weeks. Willie, I'm going to turn things over to you because you have another special announcement.
I do have a special announcement. Sam, stand up, please. This is Sam Honaker. He is going to the Navy on Tuesday. My dad was in the Navy. I have always had a fascination with naval stuff. His family has been involved in the military. His dad is a Marine. There's no such thing as a former Marine, is there, Phil? All right. And his brother is also in the Navy. But we want to send Sam off with the support of his church family. That's my purpose here today. I just want to recognize that. Thank you for your service, your willingness. To send you off the way you should be sent off, in prayer, with the Lord blessing you and keeping watch over you. So, Sam, thank you very much for your willingness to serve our nation. I will close this in prayer, and then we will sing God Bless America, and you'll be dismissed after that. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today. We just thank you for today. We thank you for Sam and his willingness to serve his nation. We thank you for this nation and ask your blessing on it. Father, we just ask that you bring a revival. Father, we do ask that you go with Sam as he leaves his family Tuesday. Go with his family, as I'm sure they will miss him. But we ask your blessing on Sam, that you would just wrap your loving arms around him as he goes off to serve this nation. Father, we do pray for the events this coming week as well. We just ask that your will be done, that you would lead and guide us as a church body and as individuals as we go forward. We just thank you. Father, we thank you most of all for your son Jesus and the work he accomplished on the cross. And it's in his holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Stand with us as we honor our country and Sam's service.
God bless America. Land that I love. Send me smile.